The one thing I love about this film is there's so much entertainment. It's so much fun, the joy, the ride of it.
Well, she might just as easily have run away from you.
Yeah, but she didn't.
Yeah, but she might have
but
done.
But she didn't.
But she might
but
have
she
done.
She didn't! Ah!
Cares!
It's visually fun and emotionally satisfying, but it also has this other thing that is what engages us as artists and makes us want to bring everything we can to it.
Yes.
There's a relentless intelligence in Stephen Sondheim, the lyrics. Every time you listen, you hear something new.
She had to raise the beans. You had to raise the
beans. Yes, you raised the beans in the first place.
Your fault.
You're responsible. You're the one to blame. It's your fault.
But at the same time, singing Stephen Sondheim is like calculus for singers and actors because everything about his work is often very challenging.
Look at your nails.
Look at your dress.
People would laugh at you.
Nevertheless,
she still wished to go to the festival and dance before the prince.
His work requires psychological exploration. You know, you're dealing with very strong human conflicts and deep relationships and everything, but then you go suddenly from dialogue into singing.
Now, remind me, what am I to return with?
Oh, you don't remember.
The cow is white as milk, the cape is red as blood, the hair is yellow as corn, the slippers...
Musically, it's challenging and thrilling at the same time.
Having seen professional productions, you know, you get 10-piece, 15-piece orchestra, and here, you know, you've got 60-piece orchestra. It's beautiful. We recorded it over a weekend where you could get the very best of the London musicians, and they were really enjoying it too. It's lovely to see.
Don't you know what's out there in the world?
We've recorded it beforehand in a studio, and they take those tracks and they pump them through the whole set.
And then we record it again on the set so that it's live. And what we ultimately end up doing is mixing the two together. When we need the recordings, we have it. And when it's live and working, we use that as well. And what you get is a seamless marriage of the two, but you get performances that are so brilliant.
Could love you more than I. What out there that I cannot supply? Stay with me.
And action.
So little girl, any path, so many worth exploring.
Wyatt Smith, my editor, has worked with me many times as well. And he's an extraordinary man because he's so musical. He knows music so well, and he knows how to cut musically, and it's very important that you don't see the editing.
Mother isn't here now.
Wrong things, right things.
Who knows what she'd say?
Who can say what's true?
Nothing's quite so clear now.
Do things, fight things.
Feel you've lost your way.
You decide.
It should feel fluid and all of one piece and seamless, and all of that is something that Wyatt knows so well.
Believe me.
The best example of that would be the first 16 minutes of the movie.
The way is clear, the light is good. I have no fear, nor no one should.
Each character is singing something a bit different. Each character is singing in a different location. And the ability to edit that in a manner that is exciting and exhilarating, yet has clarity. It is tremendous, and you're unaware of the editing, which is probably the best compliment I can give for how great the editing actually is.
And then, of course, I have a magnificent sound mixing and sound team. As you can imagine on a musical, it's very, very important.
Father said be nice. That was always their advice. So be nice, Cinderella. Good Cinderella. Nice.
You have to hear every lyric. It's a very lyric-heavy piece. And in those lyrics is the story, are the characters. They live in those lyrics.
Nice, good, nice, kind, good, nice.
Not that tight.
And so to have a mixing team and a sound editing team that knew how to create this world.
Tell me, the prince, what was he like?
You really want it to feel incredibly seamless.
He's a very nice prince.
And?
It's a very nice ball.
That's how Steve Sondheim wrote it. That's how he writes. He writes as if it's a scene. Everything's a scene. It's not a number.
He has charm for a prince, I guess.
I guess?
I don't need a wide range.
The sound design Into the Woods is very much part of the musicality of the piece, particularly because we enter a world of the woods for most of the movie. How the woods sounds and feels, the sonic texture of it, was a vital ingredient in bringing the world alive and making the woods feel vibrant and specific to the story being told at that time. My favorite thing is when people come out of seeing it, they say, I don't know what to say, it's like it's its own thing, because it's not traditional in any way, shape, or form. And that's what excites me.
I need that shoe to have a child.
That makes no sense.
I love the fun of it. That's a big part of this piece.
Thanks for the slipper.
And what's nice is that with that also comes something profound and something moving. It was all about the piece and all about the ensemble, everybody working together to create this magic.
You wish.
Hi, I'm Valerie with an interesting and much discussed fact from The Godfather. Now, it's got to do with Marlon Brando's puffy cheeks. Although popular myth suggests that Brando padded his cheeks with cotton wool to play Vito Corleone, he did so only for the audition. Before the actual filming began, he had a mouthpiece specially created by a dentist. For more movie news, keep it tuned to our channel.